what you do for a living?
Consulting, mostly. I'm a businessman.
I don't have direct contact with Wolf, you know that, right?
Yeah, but you have friends there, don't you?
Yeah, Bill Cavish, you know him? He works for Wolf, he's a friend.
Good morning, Bill. Norman Oppenheimer.
Can I say that I'm your uncle?
No.
It is my job to keep people like you away, don't you get that? Respect my position. Stop. Please.
It'd be my privilege to buy you these shoes.
If I take the shoes, I have to pay for
them. You don't have to, it's done.
Is everything okay?
Yeah. Enjoy.
You were in Arthur Tubbs' house.
Yeah.
This is my private home. No, you can't just walk in it.
Could I introduce you to him sometime? You know who he is, right?
I have to leave. This is unacceptable.
So I'll tell my partners that we had a good conversation.
You're like a drowning man trying to wave at an ocean liner.
But I'm a good swimmer.
Yeah, don't forget that.
Do you know Norman Oppenheimer?
No, I don't.
Very nice to meet you.
Thank you so much for being here, and congratulations on the film. I have to tell you, and Joseph, especially you, the writer and director, I loved this movie. I got to see it on Monday. It is the definition of delight. And I just had so much fun watching it. And what I also loved about it was that it was also a little sad. It's not just trying to be the lightest, happiest movie. It is in touch with the sadness that comes with it. So congratulations. I loved it so much. Richard, a completely different kind of performance from you than we've ever expected. You do some unbelievable work in this movie. And one of the things that you do that I love so much is you make an incredible face every time your character should be embarrassed, where it's the moment of recognition where it's unclear whether or not you're recognizing that there's embarrassment there and you're just trying to find a way to move past it, or you just know how to move past it. Talk about developing this character.
No, it's an interesting thing what you were just talking about, and it was something that we had to discover, I had to discover in this character, is that there are real defeats and humiliations, and it was, how quickly, well, let me take it back a little bit. Usually what we do, normal human beings, when they get hurt, you can't deal with a hurt, you turn it into anger. Anger somehow makes you, the pieces come back together in your, who you are. Richard Gere comes back together, I can feel this. He doesn't do that. He doesn't go from hurt to angry. He goes from hurt, pulls back in, takes the energy, and finds a way to use that for forward motion. And there are times, the way that Joseph edited, that we are allowed to see that process. He leaves enough space for that to happen. Sometimes it happens so quickly that you'd have to do it in slow motion to see how quickly he turns those humiliations into some kind of positive forward motion.
Well, it's so small and subtle, and without giving anything away, but to be specific for this question for you, you hold on to it well enough so that when it actually registers in the scene with Charlotte Gainsbourg, we know what we're looking at, and we know exactly how to identify how it's different in this moment. Can you talk about crafting that in the editing room and crafting that in the performance? Because there is a trajectory, but it's ever so subtle.
I think a lot of it is not something that we're aware of. In the editing room, you look at a performance, or you look at the different takes, the different angles that we collected during production, and you try to find the one that is moving and consistent with where the character is and somehow moves the story forward. And in some magical way, every take has something a little different. And you only know what really works when you see the progression of the whole story. Which is why sometimes on set you don't really know what you want. You have to see the whole story to know what exactly you're looking for it from Norman at a certain point. What was nice about what happened to us is that Richard became Norman in a way that allowed him to do anything, and it was still Norman. He was always in character. So it's true, almost every scene has some form of humiliation. Someone is pushing Norman away, someone is kicking him out, someone is letting him know how little he's worth. And in some great way, Richard found a language that communicated that to the audience, taking in this humiliation and not being ever in a position to turn it into anger or offense, because he can't afford to get angry at anyone.
Was it the kind of situation where as a director you're shooting multiple options to bring into the editing room, because you're not that you're not sure what's going to work, but the sort of changes are very subtle?
Yes, I think there was something about how comfortable Richard felt with this character that gave me the notion that if we just try it again or do something a little differently, I might be surprised in what will turn up.
Yeah, I mean, we worked really closely. I mean, all three of us worked very closely, and it was gradation. The script was very clear. It wasn't like, well, we have all this footage, now how do we make a movie out of it? That, when you see the movie, that was the script. And it was a brilliant script. But you never know quite what those grades are, of how much to let out, how much to cover. And I think, look, I'm really proud of this movie, and part of it is that Joseph knows when to let the audience in on emotions, with both of our characters, mm-hmm. that he knows that moment, and when it means the most, and holds it back until that moment.
Well, there's a lot of tone that you're playing with. It's very tricky. We have slapstick comedy, or at least not necessarily slapstick comedy, but classic screwball comedy at times. We have sadness and humiliation, and you are always perfect with where that line is and never really going over it. Lior, you have the wonderful opportunity in this film to play what is ostensibly a good politician. What is that like in our time to play a good politician?
You think it's a good...
Total fiction.
Could only be.
Do you really think he's a good politician?
He at least has heart.
He has heart, yeah. I think, yeah.
And
yeah.
He's striving for a form of peace.
It's because of me, because I hate politicians. I think there aren't any good politicians. They're all corrupted. They're all liars, whatever. And we would, when Joseph introduced me to this character, I was like, how am I going to do it? I mean, I'm judging the character before I'm even starting to do it. So it was kind of hard, you know, hard thing to do. But I don't know, with Richard and, of course, Joseph, it was, I mean, yeah. And apparently he's a good politician.
Well, don't get me wrong. He's still,
although I didn't mean to.
he still comes across at times as like a narcissistic egotist, like any politician. But at the same time, he has a fair amount of heart and care for the people he represents, as well as for this one lone man who he could throw away very easily.
Yeah, it's about friendship, and I mean, usually friendship, a real friendship, you got it. When, I'm sorry about my English; it's very poor English. So
no, it's very good.
It's my first gotten English, worse after that glass of wine and the bourbon back there.
It was I was supposed to be very fluently English after the glass of wine, but I guess it didn't work. Where was I?
Friendship. Friendship. The problem is not your English, my friend.
No, it is.
No, but there's a tricky thing, and it's you guys haven't seen it yet, but there is a decisive scene where we meet, and in a normal movie, this would be the cute meet between a man and a woman. And we have to make a connection in that, where I offer something, and it has to be believable that he would accept it. Mm-hmm. And it was a tricky thing for us to do, but I think the thing that worked well, and everyone should know this, if the actors trust each other, something special can happen. And Lior and I trusted each other completely, I mean, right from the beginning. So that we were helping each other achieve these moments that had to be real, the cute meets and trusting and all these, this sense of they really do like each other.
Yeah.
Has to be there.
We were actually improvising. Joseph asked us to improvise the first time, and it was the first time we met. It was like minutes after we just first met. I was excited as I'm, you know, just met Richard Gere and then he asked us to improvise, and this guy just, you know, started to do things that I I was amazed. Like, oh. And the chemistry, this is something about the chemistry between us that actually you can see it in the movie. So
100%, you can see the chemistry in the movie. Joseph, where, you know, this is your first English language film. Where did this idea come from? What made you want to tell the story of a New York fixer working with an Israeli politician?
Well, the way you describe it, it sounds like it's the most fascinating thing in the world. How can I not make a movie about that relationship? It's the Norman's character has been a mystery for me my entire life. I know Norman's. I am a Norman. I'm embarrassed by some of what Norman does.
Well, you have to be a Norman. You're a filmmaker. It's impossible to not
this
be like
is, this
Norman
is true.
To get a movie
I think
made.
I think behind every film there are many Normans who are in denial. But usually the filmmaker himself has to be someone who's willing to humiliate himself in order to get where he needs to go. And I think that's many times you think about humiliation as a negative thing, someone who doesn't have, you know, the dignity or but pride, I think, is not a good quality. And if you're trying to do something that's good or that you think is good, and you're willing to take a little humiliation for that, I think that's something to encourage. But he is embarrassing, and I can't run away from that. He's doing things that most people would consider pushy, aggressive, maybe even scheming. And at the same time, if you go through this story from his perspective, it's actually just a reflection of his loneliness. And when I realized that that's what's behind this character, I felt like I had to put that on screen. Everyone is judging Norman. Everyone is looking for ways to avoid him. And I loved him, and I found this way to understand him that I just had to share with an audience.
Well, he's so desperately trying to prove that he is worth something more than their negative judgment. It's a beautiful performance once again. Richard, how did you first see Norman when you read the script? Was everything that's in your performance there for you on the script?
No, we had. Joseph is a really interesting guy, and he. It essentially works like I do. I like to work very slowly. I don't want to. I think there's only one time I've made a movie, and we had to shoot within 2 weeks of my saying yes. We had this incredible luxury of having 8 or 9 months to talk about this, and for me to get inside of his head of where this character came from and the movie came from, and his incredible generosity and doggedness to feed me all of the mind, the heart of himself, but the character and 2,000 years of Jewish history and whatever, all these things that I was being fed. And I was a sponge soaking this up. Now, I've lived in New York for 20 years, since I was 40-something years. And so this Norman is somewhere inside of me. I know this guy. This specific one, I still don't have a clue as to who this guy is. He is so unique. He's a Norman, but he's a very specific Norman that happened in the course of making this movie. And I think he refers to all the other Normans, but he's really his own unique creature. But I think it was really informed by the slowness of our approach that when we got to shooting, I was saturated with him. And I felt confident that anything I did was going to be Norman.
Well, it's the kind of performance that's so embodied, you can see it just in your walk. When you're walking on screen, it feels like you're walking as Norman. How did you develop that? Was that also just by the time you started rolling, it was just in you? You felt it?
Yeah, I mean, a lot of this, there was one day that Joseph called me up on the phone. He said, you know, I want to, could you just record something? Just do Norman. He never had done it before, do Norman. And I hadn't been kind of ready to do Norman yet, quite, to make that decision. I said, let's just play, because I can't remember what reason you gave me for it.
We need to time. We storyboarded a sequence, and we needed the timing of it. So I wanted an audio reference for the whole sequence.
So I just started playing on the phone with a voice, and it started to evolve, the beginnings of who he was and his speech patterns. It was, again, when you have time like this, you don't have to make critical decisions. They just kind of sneak up on you in dreams, and they emerge when they want to in a kind of an authentic, natural way. His physicality just kind of happened. I didn't have to think about it.
Some things that you pick up from the story that give you a key for his whole body language. Norman is constantly trying to to push his way into an area that he's not invited. That informs his whole being.
It was one of the first things we shot. It was in Central Park. What did you show here before?
What did you show?
It was the trailer. So that's actually in there. And I'm following along. I'm trying to sell something to Dan Stevens. And we were on a Steadicam shot and leading Dan, and I'm behind him. And I'm following behind, and I'm being Norman. And I remember him saying, can you kind of like bob, like you're looking over one shoulder and then the other one? And immediately I felt that other thing kick in, that was his need to be seen. And not just seen, but be seen, be essential somehow.
We were shooting in the streets of New York. There's a scene where Richard stalks me, is following me all over the streets of New York. And we were shooting on Sunday, I think it was Sunday. A lot of people on the streets, you know, there's a film crew, so everybody's taking pictures. And almost nobody recognized him because the way he walks, the way he was moving, he was like, they knew I was, the camera followed me, but it didn't, I mean, they don't know me. So what are they shooting? I was shooting a film with Richard Gere. So where's Richard? And nobody knew because he was like so Norman in a way. So,
well, Richard, you've gotten used to this with Time Out of Mind, filming on the street as someone else that nobody recognizes, right?
Well, we learned, I mean, we inherited on this movie, I think, some of the techniques that we figured out on Time Out of Mind. And we had, these are very low budget films we're talking. You can't control New York City. And we don't have a lot of extras. Most of those shots in the streets that was New York. And if you do it right, you do it with intelligence and you have a small movie making footprint and you're in character, no one cares in New York. They're in their own world. They're going from here to there. They don't really want to see anything in between. And especially with the world now where you're talking on your phone and you kind of tune out the rest of the world, you can make a film like this and have long takes. I mean, we had some long takes of a couple of minutes. I mean, some of those things where no one would break up the shooting. I mean, that's pretty incredible.
Richard, you have an incredible career and amazing movies that you've been in. But in the past few years with this and Time Out of Mind, you know, these low-budget films, as you refer to them, it seems that you're doing some of your most daring work as an actor. Does it feel that way? Do you feel like you're sort of free to do some of these incredible roles that you've taken up? Does it feel different at all?
No, people have been asking me that kind of question. These are the kind of movies that I've always made. They were made before in studios because that was part of what studios did. They did big movies, they did small movies, they did comedies, they did, you know, little dramas, whatever. So it's the same kind of movie, but look, Time Out of Mind took me about 12 years to develop. Though it's a huge commitment to figure out how to make that movie and make it special. You worked 5 years more, probably, on trying to figure out how to tell this story and make it work. I've always been interested in character and honesty, and we're all extremely peculiar. I'm amazed that people can make movies and make characters that look normal. That to me is bizarre. We're all so strange, all of us. And to embrace that and allow characters to express themselves in unexpected ways, but very human ways, is certainly a lineage of filmmaking that I feel very comfortable with. Now, we have to do it now, very low budget. This was, for a low budget film, 32 days or whatever it was, is almost a long shoot.
Yeah, that's pretty good compared to most of the people that I talked to.
21 yeah. days on Time Out of Mind. So, but that's still very short. The old days, this would have been a 50-day shoot, 55-day shoot maybe. And the the working that fast, I like. I mean, you're used to that in Israel, working that fast.
Yeah, working very fast.
Maybe even
like
faster than
15
we did.
To 18 days, maybe 22, it's the most, I mean.
Yeah, well, you're like doing 5 or 6 pages a day in that, right? Yeah.
A lot of them.
Yeah.
Lior, did you base your character on anybody, base your performance on any politicians that you could think of?
No, it's a collage of politicians because I was trying to talk with, I mean, when I was researching, I was trying to talk to a couple of the Israeli politicians that I thought were, you know, they were similar to the profile that I thought this character is, but no one actually wanted to speak with me.
Well, did you open those conversations with
politicians? No, I was, you know, I told them what is the movie about, and they told me, oh, okay, well, let me think about it, and day after they said, listen, no, we don't want anything. And you know, when you see now, I mean, the the news in Israel. So we have like a prime minister with a lot of investigations about corruptions, and with American business man. So it's kind of, he's a prophet actually, because there are like headlines in the newspaper, which almost like, if, when you see the movie, it's like copy paste from the newspaper into the screen. So I was, most of things I was doing like my own, you know, thought and with Joseph.
I would vote for Lior if he ever ran for office.
And well, I would too.
In any country, so.
Okay.
I would say this feels like light corruption though compared to what we see on a daily basis. I will say that.
That's a very American thing. I mean, it's like they get a big deal about shoes in this movie, right? And the current one in Israel is about cigars.
And I'm cigars going, and pink champagne.
Pink champagne. Yeah. And a little jewelry.
If only in America it could be about cigars and pink champagne.
dramatically, light corruption is more interesting than actual corruption. Actual corruption is clear. There's no moral question. The light corruption is fascinating to me because these characters are doing things that seem wrong, but they're able to justify them to themselves. And I think most of the wrong things that we end up doing, we justify to ourselves. So that gray area is interesting. Yeah, right. So that if it was a clear corruption movie, which we've seen many times, I don't think I would have had an interest in it.
There's a wonderful sequence in the film, Joseph, where we see a montage of faces that Norman has met at a recent soiree, to not give anything away in regards to the plot. And you do this wonderful thing that feels very screwball comedy from like the 1940s and 50s, sort of Billy Wilder-esque. Were you thinking about that when you were shooting that? I mean, where did that sort of concept come from for how to montage all those faces together?
No, so it's a scene that takes place in Washington where Norman, after he's acknowledged by the prime minister, suddenly is the center of the room and everyone wants to know who he is. Who is this guy who's so...
First time in his life.
Right.
I didn't want to give away that he became the prime minister.
So. Okay, well, I think it's somehow a reflection of my own experience when that happened to me, or the few times where I felt that happening to me. Where you, so most rooms that I go into, definitely when I'm with a movie star, no one really wants to know who I am, or no one comes up to me. But every once in a while, there's this situation where you are the center, and then there's this dizziness or this circus of everyone coming up to you, wanting something, offering something. So it's just an effort to put on the screen something that I felt once or twice in my life, and putting that on into Norman's perception. So it's all these faces coming up, or all these people suddenly really, really, really nice to Norman, and it's at once a great feeling, and also something that causes nausea.
The moderate rise.
Right. It's moderate.
Let's get some questions from the audience. Right here.
Hi, guys. Thanks for being here. I actually just got back from Israel a few months ago, and I learned so much. I'm actually really excited to see the film. My question is for all three of you. What is the most important thing that you look at when you accept a project? And for Richard also, I just want to ask you, I love Chicago. That's probably my favorite movie of all time. Would you ever consider doing any more singing roles?
Yeah, I mean, what fun. I actually started, when I came to New York, I've been doing regional theaters, and I came to New York and I had long hair and I could play musical instruments, I was a musician also, and it was the time of rock musicals. So I was working, like, as soon as I came to New York, and I did like 3 or 4 musicals right away, and I didn't do any more. And I did Chicago, and the memory I had of what the joy of just playing. Musicals is a lot of just fun, and especially that movie was really fun for all of us. Super fun.
So what do you guys look for in a project when you accept it? I think that was your first question, right? Lior?
It's supposed to be interesting. I mean, the role, I'm trying to challenge myself because I'm 22 years of career, and I think I've done most of the thing I could do in my casting. So I'm trying to find now something which are way from my, you know, personality. Or so it's the first thing I look on a script to see if there's any challenge in it. Usually,
Joseph, I'm going to change the question a little bit for you. You've made a number of films at this point.
No one's offering me any to play any roles in any movies.
That's why I'm changing the question for you. How many ideas do you have for movies that you end up sort of discarding until you find one that you really think you can dig down into?
Hundreds. But there's so many great ideas that feel like fantastic movies for about 2 minutes. And since I already know what happens to great ideas that can't develop into something that really works on screen, I've become extremely skeptical about any good idea that immediately says, I'm a great movie. From my experience, I'll start working on a movie when I have no choice. When there's something about the core of a story that becomes absolutely necessary for me to figure out. And that truthfully, is very rare. It comes along every couple of years. That's that's been my experience.
What was the core of this story for you that pushed you into working on it?
So there's something about the duality in Norman. Being proud of him, thinking that he's a genius, and at the same time, there's something despicable about him. That duality seemed to be a variation of my own identity crisis. And when I realized that I had to figure out how those two things can exist in one being, I couldn't do anything else. So that's how that story became a movie.
And Richard, what about you? What attracts you to a role?
You know, there has to be I call it a falling in love moment, where you just, it's not a rational decision. You're sucked into a story. You can feel it. You're reading the script and you feel the movie in your body. That kind of mysterious energy comes up, which is the energy that can allow you to create. That if you don't fall in love with the script, I don't know how to do it. You know, this process of what we do to me is very mysterious in itself. And if that kind of crazy energy doesn't come up, and that falling in love with the material, falling in love with the character, things open up, things expand. I mean, it's almost a mystical thing starts to happen that I don't even know where to begin. But that's not the end of it. And then you talk to Joseph. You read this great script. You feel it. And then for me, there has to be this rapport. There has to be a sense of, well, we're coming from the same universe of that we want to create and inhabit. And I also feel safe. I have to feel safe with him, or I'm not going to take chances. I'm going to edit myself. And as you'll see, I mean, it's a pretty extreme character that I play in this. If I didn't trust him, I don't think I would have felt the confidence to go as far as I did.
Does feeling safe mean being able to articulate his vision clearly enough for you to understand exactly what you're going to do?
No, I don't want to know exactly. I don't think he wants to know exactly. And one of my fears is working with him is that he's so meticulous in his screenplays. I'm sure you've done more than me. They're very precise and beautifully written. I mean, they could be published as they are. And I was afraid maybe it was going to be so hermetically sealed that it wouldn't allow for me to bring my thing to it. But then as soon as we started talking, and I realized that he also wanted to come from a magical space, that dreaming was going to be as valid as the kind of empirical work of, well, where does the guy live? What's his apartment? You know, does he have a girlfriend? Does he have a boyfriend? And you start from those kind of rational places of asking the questions. With a character like this, they're completely irrelevant. Completely. And as soon as I realized that, I would have to dive into this and trust that he would meet me somewhere out there in the mystic and take over. But it does come from that script first.
All that said, I know he doesn't have a girlfriend, but if the character Norman did ever have a girlfriend, I would really want to meet that character in a movie. It's like a fascinating...
She'd be really strange. Really weird.
We have to get some more audience questions, but we're talking so much about your writing and very complimentary about your writing, and the script is really beautiful. Joseph, I'm curious what your writing process is like, because you throw ideas away. You said, do you write every day? Do you wake up and write and see what you have, or do you wait till the idea really feels like it can last that you dive in and start writing?
So I've always had a hard time talking about the writing process. And I, when I meet another writer or when I'm in one of these sessions, I'm curious to hear what other people do. But there's something mysterious that happens. When I don't have something to write, then I don't write. And when I do have something to write, then it just writes itself. Now that sounds kind of, I don't know, too spiritual, but it's really been my experience. And I mean, there's a cliche of looking at an empty page and all these techniques of never having an empty page. I don't like those techniques. An empty page means that you have to continue searching for something that will not only fill the page, but fill your wells, fill your need to put something out. I don't think good writing ever comes out of a formula. It has to erupt in some natural, intuitive way.
Next question.
Gentlemen, it's nice to see you all. I actually saw a preview of the film last week at CinemaCon. Really look forward to seeing it. But my question's for Richard. You've been in so many iconic roles. What's the film that got away or the role that you wish you had done? Good answer.
Next question.
I could think of many roles that I wish you would have done.
Look, I'm not going to tell you which ones, but there are movies that I wanted to do, and I chased them. I volunteered, you know, I kind of forced a meeting, whatever. I never got a job that way, ever. And it's, I've had a very incredible career. I'm amazed that I'm still doing this and I'm still working with great people and I'm still falling in love with scripts and ideas and everything. But so whatever course it's taken me to some fruitful place. So.
Next question. Who's got a microphone? Right.
Hello, gentlemen. Thank you for being here. So what special advice would you give to filmmakers or actors that's trying to make it to this business?
What advice would you give to filmmakers or actors that are trying to make it in this business?
Make yourself interesting. That's the job, because that's what is going to be on screen, whether you're a director or you're a writer or an actor. It's whatever you keep enriching yourself, because that's the only thing you have to work with.
But not too interesting. I mean, shouldn't be weird like interesting. It would be trying to be your own, that's it. No, I mean, it's like how interesting and trying to, you know.
To be interesting, but not weird, basically.
Let me delete this one.
Joseph, what about you? What would you say as a filmmaker?
I'm going to say something that contradicts itself, but I think not to give up, because you hear so many rejections, and most of the rejections are justified. It's a good thing that someone's holding you back, because you probably need to either get better or get the thing you're doing to a riper stage. But then there is some point where giving up is actually the best thing to do. So it's maybe my best advice is to be very closely attuned to when that point is. Persist and continue doing what you believe in. But if the world is really, really resisting it and saying no, then find something else.
let me clarify what I meant by interesting, because I know what Lior was objecting to in that, but it's not. Look, I'm 67 years old, so I think I'm the oldest guy in the room. Yes, for sure. That's all you've got at the end of the day of what you've thought, what you've felt. How much you can get the idea of you out of the way so that you can become bigger and smarter and more compassionate and feel the temperature of any room that you're in. I mean, that's the grist for the creative mill. But to have that strength that, look, I had, there were actors in my acting classes that certainly were as good as me. They gave up. At some point, they just went, nah, I can't do it. I can't take it. So having that sense that you do have something extraordinary to give, and in the right, there will be a moment that it comes out. There is a moment that the flowers that you have will bloom and other people will see it and you'll be ready for it.
Unless you have Joseph whispering in your ear, just give up. Just let it go.
No, the point is knowing when that point is very hard. Most of us will only recognize it in retrospect. But there is a skill that people have to know intuitively when to continue and when to give up, and that's necessary. But the first thing I said is more important than the second thing. Having willpower to continue doing something despite all the hardships, that's probably the most important element that at least allowed me to make the movies that I did.
Well, thankfully, none of you guys have given up because Norman, The Moderate Rise and Tragic Fall of a New York Fixer is an absolutely wonderful movie, and I'm so glad
Thank
that it
you.
Was made and I got to see it. And when can everybody else see it? When can people see Norman, Richard?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow?
It opens tomorrow.
Go see Norman, The Moderate Rise in theaters. Thank
tomorrow.
You so much.
Who's out there? See it tomorrow. See it on Friday. Be in the early show, that 10 o'clock show, tomorrow.
Guys, thank you so much for being here. Thank you.
Thank you.